I love the Firaxis XCOM games. From Enemy Unknown to War of the Chosen, their tactful take on translating the original XCOM strategy and management for the next generation have made them some of my favourite titles for the past few years. Granted, I put a lot of my thoughts on this into an XCOM 2 review almost 2 years ago, but for those who don't want to go video hopping, and don't want to see how poor my old production values were, I'll summarise my points as so. Working from the template of the original UFO defence, Enemy Unknown brought forward the time-worn push and pull of managing a base with commanding soldiers on the field. You pump money into research and development, so your soldiers can pump bullets into space monsters. The motivation for all these games has been to win a war at all costs, but how you do so is totally within your control, based on what facilities you build back at base, what soldiers you have in play, and much, much more. Then there's this delicious tension that comes from keeping those plates spinning month by month, especially in the face of an increasing alien threat. The highs are dizzying, and the lows are absolutely crushing. Losing a soldier, a satellite, or a council member might be the first domino towards defeat. Unless you can find a way to, as the subtitle suggests, survive, adapt, and overcome. What's most appealing about them is the fact that they're a generator for war stories. That challenge causes you to slowly fall in love with the soldiers you're commanding, and with a wealth of customization options, you can even go to town making them look like people you know or detailing their epic backstories. When they pull off impossible shots or unlock new ranks, you're as proud as a parent on school sports day. When they get killed in the heat of battle though, well, you often have to find a dark corner to sit in. All these new XCOM titles carry these elements forward and improve on them. But there's something else. Where Enemy Unknown and especially War of the Chosen succeeds over the originals is in their timeliness. The fact that they can be played with a controller on a games console means that much of their presentation and quality of life inclusions ensure that anybody can pick up and play them, without losing anything that made UFO Defense originally a hit. Is Bushnell's Law in full effect? Easy to learn, hard to master. You may never be by the aliens the first time you play, but that defeat isn't off-putting. You'll know that next time you will. And then you do, maybe in a few weeks. But then, maybe, you'll try and do it in a few days, while slowly taking off stabilizers like quick saves until you're playing the game on a knife's edge. This is the quintessential Enemy Unknown experience, tweaked in XCOM 2, and then built on for War of the Chosen. It's likely that Firaxis' take on XCOM will continue to develop on these great points for years to come. It's already reached that much coveted accolade of directly inspiring other games, Codename Steam, Invisible Ink, Mario & Rabbids Kingdom Battle, all of which have taken that new XCOM template and put a new spin on it. However, there was a time that we may not have gotten Firaxis' take on XCOM. Okay, well not quite. Certainly, the title of XCOM Enemy Unknown might have been held by a different game altogether, one that did not see the light of day. At least not as originally intended. Today, after spending nearly 5 minutes talking about XCOM Enemy Unknown, I want to talk about the Bureau, XCOM Declassified, the end of those initial Enemy Unknown experiments. The result is now a nearly 6-year-old third-person shooter by the developers of Bioshock 2, that seemed to up and disappear without much of a trace. Ironically, the game that was meant to be the revelation of XCOM Secret History is pretty much doomed to become Secret History. So why, especially as a fan of Firaxis' take on XCOM, would I want to sell you on it? After all, wasn't this the game that was created because of the supposed non-audience for classic PC strategy games like UFO Defense? The game that chased trends like third-person shooting and Hollywood presentation instead of staying true to the core identity of the series? That game that had this marketing material associated with it?
YOLO.
Over there!
YOLO!
Move out!
Moving!
YOLO! YOLO!
Go! Move out!
No, no!
Move out!
YOLO! I never saw parents!
Whoops.
Well, sure, but that's not really telling the whole story. There's much more to the strange historical relic of the XCOM franchise, and, well, I want to explain why it's an underrated gem. I'm not expecting to convert the hardcore from one flavour of XCOM to another, but if you want to appreciate a game that challenged the core structure of an XCOM title and managed to succeed in some key places, then get comfortable. It's time to head back to 1962, to a time before XCOM existed in our world and theirs, where a group of military men and women from all backgrounds came together to face a threat they weren't expecting, and the story of what happened next.
Lights. We are at war, and not the one we were expecting. Our combined military forces have been routed. The comms have gone dark. The red phone will not be ringing. The Bureau was founded to coordinate resistance forces in the event of a complete and successful Soviet invasion. That mission remains the same, even if our enemy does not. We now face an opponent from beyond our world, whose identity is yet unknown. But make no mistake, this enemy has crippled us. They have technology decades beyond what we possess. We must make it our own. Their weapons will become our weapons. And when they do, we shall annihilate them. I give you new orders. Survive. Adapt. Win. Welcome to XCOM.
I'd like to use a quote by then head of 2K Games, Christoph Hartmann. This was his response to the feedback of the XCOM 2010 trailer, the one that had reimagined the dormant strategy series as a first-person shooter in the style of Bioshock. In it, he defends a change in genre as a sign of the times, and says this.
I use the example of music artists. Look at someone old school like Ray Charles. If he would make music today, it would still be Ray Charles, but he would probably do it more in the style of Kanye West. Bringing Ray Charles back is all fine and good, but it just needs to move on, although the core essence will still be the same.
As you might expect, this quote didn't exactly go over well with fans.
Betrayal!
What?
Betrayal! Betrayed me! This game sucks!
If you don't recognize the screaming man next to a young angry Joe there, this is Noah Spoonie Antweiler, a dedicated XCOM fan. His reaction is the most extreme of the kind of thing that Christoph was attempting to respond to at the time. And you know, I can't really blame him. First-person shooter reboots were the hot trend of the late 2000s. Starbreeze's reboot of the strategy series Syndicate maybe being the best example of that. It wasn't immediately apparent what, if anything, it brought over from the original. It didn't adapt its aesthetic, its tone, its setting, or any of its mechanics. To the more cynical out there, experiments like this felt like they only share the same name to coast from a familiar IP. Less of a creative pursuit, and more of an economic one. On the surface, the XCOM 2010 reboot and its transformation into the Bureau fits this. Gears of War in XCOM clothing isn't the most enticing idea. I mean, hey, XCOM already tried to be a third-person shooter back in the early 2000s, in the dumbest way possible.
I'm just getting bigger and uglier. Look out!
But the more I see that quote about Ray Charles, the more I realize that maybe he was right. Though not in the way he anticipated. After all, if XCOM UFO Defense is a Ray Charles sample, and say 2K Marin are Kanye West, and I guess that makes the Bureau. Okay, right. Just enough not to get flagged. I don't make this analogy just for fun. Although I do a bit of that as well. The reason that the Bureau works isn't because it just chops and skews XCOM to make something popular. Instead, it collaborates with it, takes the texture of its design and extrapolates it into a full composition. Things that might have been incidental details in the original are instead put into focus here. It's respectful and reverential, maybe not in the way that Enemy Unknown's slavish adaptation of its presentation and mechanics were, but instead in carrying that spirit into a new realm. For example, how did XCOM UFO Defense become XCOM UFO Defense? Well, it'd be easy to point at developers Julian and Nick Golub, the publishers Microprose, and the popularity of PC strategy titles at the time, and say that lightning struck just at the right time. However, you don't settle on an extraterrestrial military thriller without a little inspiration. To influence the look and feel of UFO Defense, the developers went through a history of alien pop culture. The Roswell crash and its little grey men. Bob Lazar's upholstery of alien technology. Gerry Anderson's UFO, a British sci-fi series about a military intervention in an alien invasion, provided much of XCOM's mechanical and tonal flair. But more importantly, it had an entire catalogue of classic alien invasion movies to base itself on. Things like Invasion of the Body Snatchers, The Blob, The Day the Earth Stood Still, The Thing from Another World. Cinema that planted in the public consciousness what aliens look like and their intentions for Earth. The origin of the classic alien invasion story might be H.G. Wells' War of the Worlds. However, the kind of paranoid B-movie alien invasion of late 20th century cinema is rooted in far more modern American history. The post-war hysteria of the Red Scare. In his book, Transforming the Screen, Peter Lev writes,
"Invasion films were common in the 1950s, featuring a variety of aliens portrayed as superior to Earthlings, both in intelligence and technology. In these films, aliens represent what some Americans feared about the Soviets. Sometimes the invaders used the strategy of infiltration, taking over the minds of the people, making slaves of them, or appropriating their bodies, thus making war unnecessary. The result of infiltration is loss of free will, loss of identity, and disintegration of the family and community. The takeover represents what many Americans believed would occur in a communist invasion."
Following the end of the Second World War and the dawn of the Atomic Age, the relationship between the Western superpowers and the Soviet Union had turned tense. This Cold War wasn't fought exclusively with weapons, but it was waged on political, economic, and propaganda fronts. The biggest of these fronts was the space race between the USA and the USSR. A means to capture not only the public's imagination, but to show the industrial prowess of their respective countries. That rocket technology that destroyed so many cities could feasibly send a man to the moon, and the first country to pull this off would be considered the superior power. You could understand why the United States could be a paranoid wreck in these trying times. Not only was the US trying to keep the communists from the doorstep, but they were trying to keep them out of space as well. The Soviets weren't just gunning for the stars, but to the average American they might as well have been from there. Hollywood, feeling the pressure of communist investigations in their own ranks, managed to translate those anxieties into the most popular medium of the time, motion pictures. It's unsurprising then that the original XCOM would co-opt much of the Xerox paranoia, even if it wasn't totally intentional. Which is why intentionally setting the Bureau in 1962, the year John Glenn orbited the Earth and the Cuban Missile Crisis kicked off, was such a masterstroke. This wasn't XCOM just riffing on material. Now it could be a part of it. It could add details like making XCOM once a defense mechanism against a Soviet invasion and not just an alien one. It could give you a main character that, fittingly, was a paranoid G-man now shaken further by these events. And like the Cold War itself, the Bureau wasn't entirely about fighting back through firepower alone. It was also about keeping America in the dark, blacking out communications and rounding up those affected. It was about putting a spin on moments where the Earth was minutes away from utter annihilation.
5 degrees, 23 minutes east. Barnes, what the hell did I just nuke?
Bikini Atoll, nuclear test site.
Good work, Barnes. Let's head home.
It's a subversion of that usual second layer to XCOM. Both the Bureau and, say, newer XCOM games are firstly about fighting back aliens directly, seen only through the eyes of those back at base and the soldiers in the field. But whereas, say, War of the Chosen will then have you create propaganda to inspire Earth's population to fight back, well, the Bureau actively destroys this information where it can. The most apt example of this may be in the game's final moments, where the pitch-black reality of the situation is revealed. After the day is saved, all that alien technology, all those infected, were dismantled and destroyed. It's not all bad, though. For its development on XCOM as a technical facility, the developers could look at the American military's history of space travel. The lead writer of the Bureau cites Tom Wolfe's book The Right Stuff as a major inspiration. An account of the US space program from the post-war rocket experiments to the Mercury project. You can see it laminated through the final work of the Bureau. They're both stories about Americans working under pressure to solve a cosmic task. How we needed to find people with the titular right stuff to push beyond their regular 210% of effort. It's just that 2K Marin's tale has a lot more shooting in it. Best of all, the Bureau leveraged the aesthetic strength of the time by trading the cold, skeuomorphic presentation of the older games for something warmer and more tangible. This is lo-fi sci-fi, rendered in all the attention to detail the developers showed in their Bioshock work. This military base isn't just abstract representation. It's warm and smoky theatre, with enormous reel-by-reel computers and glorious laboratories. An ashtray on every desk, a hat on every stand. Even when compared to its peers at the time, as an Unreal Engine 3 game, it holds up incredibly well, especially in scenes where art direction is fully at the wheel. Tying it all together is a soundtrack by Bioshock composer Gary Scheinman that trades the rousing military sound of Enemy Unknown for tense jazz percussion. It all forms together to create what is essentially a XCOM period piece, fitting for its more story-driven approach. And, well, being a period piece works out in another way fitting for the franchise. Because it is set in the 1960s, it must have a cast that be somewhat normative for its time and place. Those in charge are older American men, including your main character and much of his squad. But that additional cast of characters that surrounds you are much more subversive. There's the female agent Angela Weaver, the African-American pilot Leon Barnes, closeted homosexual scientist Alan Weir. This isn't just diversity for the sake of it, it establishes the XCOM of Enemy Unknown, that took on all genders, races and orientations to fight in their war. Importantly for the Bureau, their different backgrounds gives a much more nuanced perspective into this world of XCOM than it would be just through your character's eyes. In trying to stay too faithful to the original UFO defense, Enemy Unknown and even much of War of the Chosen misses the opportunity that setting the story in another time could have achieved. Again, it riffs on the material, but never really digs into it like the Bureau does. But I get it, this is salad dressing. Without something substantial for it to support, it might as well just be postcards. What are you doing? And, well, why are you doing it? Well, I'm glad you asked. The developers didn't need to put in the level of detail of its 1960s setting, but considering the change in camera angle from an overhead management game to an over-the-shoulder shooter, it made sense. Bringing things to ground level makes things more personal, and requires extra detail. But in changing that camera angle, it changes the type of game this is. Although Enemy Unknown and War of the Chosen might present its action and even base much of its design language on the third-person cover shooter, it is still a turn-based tactical game, with the addition of base management to back it up. The Bureau doesn't really have that base management side. Rather, much of the work of research, development, and appealing to the top brass is done through traditional cutscenes, dialogue sections, and incidental world detail. It's a much more immediate kind of adventure, and your successes are less reliant on every plate spinning, and instead making sure you can just navigate your main character to success. By that token then, you would think that the strategy side of XCOM has also been simplified for the Bureau. Well, fortunately not. Although you do have a main character to worry about, he is always joined on mission with two other squad members, and keeping them alive is absolutely necessary. Although they are capable enough of taking care of themselves, you will get so much more out of directing them. That's why the Bureau adapted the command bar of Enemy Unknown into a radio menu called Battle Focus. Instead of the point and click of a mouse, it's the more intuitive point and pull of a third-person shooter. You're still given all the cover detail of the enemies on the field and given a lot of different options to deal with them, so it's not a step back at all in depth. More interestingly, employing the command menu doesn't stop time completely. Merely, it buys you a breath to place your soldiers and set the commands. It feels the closest games have managed to adapt the notion of keeping a cool head during a firefight. It's the one aspect the Bureau needed to get right to appeal to strategy fans of XCOM, and I'd argue it does so excellently. It's intuitive to use, and it doesn't skimp content. It adapts a core XCOM tenet, and it makes it fit in the template of a new genre. Best of all, the Bureau didn't even need to reduce the scope of its level design to make it work. In fact, by having a character-driven interface, the developers make arenas more natural in their cover placement and shapes, unlike the strictly cubic formations of Enemy Unknown's environments. Again, the Bureau is not afraid to break from slavish recreations of UFO defense if it will improve the quality of the final product, which this does. It brings back the recognizable antagonists of UFO defense and Enemy Unknown, but gives them a bit more shape through this change of perspective and engagement. The best example I can think of might be the drones, who are a small annoyance in Enemy Unknown, while in the Bureau they're attention grabbers that require you to always keep an eye in the sky. It's not just the number challenge of taking out as many enemies in as little moves as possible as is the case in Enemy Unknown, but it's also a coordination one as well. When the game veers into more interesting mechanical opportunities is when things get exciting. There is a boss fight that subverts your reliance on cover. It's not much, but considering the game is already relying on you to use the entire breadth of the command menu to coordinate combat, well, it only reaffirms that this isn't just your run-of-the-mill third-person cover shooter. Granted, destructible cover across the board would have been fantastic, but, you know, hey. Is it better than War of the Chosen? Well, it's different. Combat in a game like that is much more about setting up the mousetrap. You'll put one guy into Overwatch, another in slashing distance, so that one shot from a character all the way over here will trigger the other two. It's satisfying in that same way the rest of the game manages to be. It's throwing a Hail Mary early on and seeing the results pay out in glorious fashion. It's calling your shots and pulling them off. The Bureau is a game where you're still making those plays, but you're not doing it to set traps for your chess pieces. Instead, it's because the situation changed a minute ago and you need to react. It's a war that feels, well, more like a war, where although you're given all the tools needed to achieve a victory, you're often not given enough time to do so. It's sink or swim. While I wouldn't want it in every XCOM game, I love it here. It fits the smaller and more personal nature of this setting and story. And what ties this all together is a plot that, although it seems a little light on the surface, manages to subvert the expectations of the audience in a way that digs right into the heart of its setting and even the nature of XCOM. I would say that if you haven't played the game, I would maybe skip this section and find out for yourself. That said, considering you're probably watching this either because you've played it already or you never intended to, well, you have been warned. The story itself is exactly what you would expect from an XCOM game. Aliens invade, you stop them. It's not your story to rewrite, but instead you're the soldier pushed through set pieces with the intent of getting to that final alien defeat. You see the size of this threat not from the drone's bird's eye presentation of older games, but from the soldier's eye view. And the developers don't shy away from the ramifications of that. You see loved ones rendered to ash, streets filled with bodies, monolithic towers floating feet above a placid suburb. It's XCOM as horror, and not just in its difficulty. Between those shock moments, you make some friends, you lose some. You'll even get to ride around in XCOM's awesome flying saucer. Did I mention that XCOM built a flying saucer? No, it's not the main plot of the Bureau that's interesting, though it is a wonderful vehicle for great levels, squelchy spooks, and 60s decor. Like those tales of epic headshots and coming back from the brink of death, this is a character-driven story, and that character is William Carter. Although touched upon previously, a reason needs to be given for why there's not a lot of management in this XCOM, and why it is more in the form of a third-person shooter. That's because, unlike most XCOM games, you are not playing as the XCOM commander. That's this guy, Myron Falk. Instead, you play as William Carter, an ex-CIA agent with a tragic past. He can shoot, he can take orders, and he can certainly give orders too. William Carter is kind of your typical hero of the time. He sounds like Lego Batman and he looks like your granddad.
You work in teams here. Seems like you're more accustomed to operating alone.
Yeah, well, I'm also accustomed to the enemy being human.
He doesn't play well with others, and boy, he sure does hate those aliens. The kind of guy that you can put on the box out of a big robot arm and hope it sells. But throughout the game, we begin to grasp that maybe he's not exactly who he says that he is. His actions in the field are incredibly lucid for a stunted alcoholic who's been sitting behind a desk for the past few years. Plus, if he really is such a bad team player, why is he a trusted commander? Is ludonarrative friction rearing its head? Well, rather, in the game's climactic moments, we learn that we were never really in William Carter all along. Well, William Carter, the character, does exist, with his own defined personality and traits, but we were only commanding him. We never got a choice to customize him like a soldier, nor really influence much of his decisions, and this was intentional. The developers wanted to write a game where an XCOM soldier had their own identity, and explore just how they would feel being commanded by a higher being. The being in this case being an ethereal, who acts as a neutral party between the invaders and the Earthlings. One that at the beginning of the game hid in a briefcase and bound itself to William Carter to save his life. One that, as you've probably figured out by now, allowed William Carter to have the level of tactical know-how he would have otherwise had to have waited 32 years until 1994's UFO defense to get.
Sometimes the invaders use the strategy of infiltration, taking over the minds of the people, making slaves of them, or appropriating their bodies, thus making war unnecessary. The takeover represents what many Americans believed would occur in a communist invasion.
The Bureau XCOM Declassified is your typical alien invasion story on the surface, and then it becomes a very atypical one. You were the alien invader. You took over the mind of one soldier to win a war. Not for the other alien invaders, but for the humans. Going back to that setting and its need for a normative character, well, William Carter is a paranoid control freak, the kind of wound-up government man you'd have as the antagonist in a family-friendly alien movie. And going back to those traits that I mentioned, many of the clues were just out of frame. The fact that this tragic loss haunts him is because this was something that was out of his control. The moment that it's revealed that a symbiotic alien has been the reason for his prowess on the field, he isn't enlightened. In fact, he rigs the base with explosives to oust the alien from his body. This is the kind of story that can only really work in the medium of video games. A postmodern battle of character versus author. Or, in this case, controller. Often games have heroic characters turn heel, but you're usually fully in control. Rarely has a game had the main character turn on you in the final moments. The thing is that your story doesn't end there. Having the main character turn on you in the final moments is just a plot twist. And there was more that the developers wanted to do to make the point of the commander-soldier relationship. So when you give up control of William Carter and return him to his base self, you now have an option of taking on a new host. Brilliantly, they're two of those subversive characters, the scientist and the agent, who looked at the world with a much more hopeful attitude than Carter. The third character, Myron Falk himself, the XCOM commander, the man with the vision to work collaboratively to overcome this threat. If the question is how could you fix a character like William Carter, they are the answer. They're willing to fight with alien technology against alien technology. Retro as hell, spacesuits and all, for the greater good. When the freed Carter goes against orders and begins to write the final mission, you're then also given a choice to slaughter or spare him. It's asking what you want from this soldier. Does he deserve retribution, or instead do you leave him as a relic of the past, paving the way for the all-colours future of XCOM Enemy Unknown? The Bureau could have just been a player-driven war story game, but it could not have had a story reveal like this. It's why I've been thinking about this game ever since the first time I played it. This strange follow-up to Enemy Unknown that zagged where that zigged. It didn't try and recreate UFO defense for the modern age through the latest design trends and technology, but instead transformed it through a little introspection. What does it really mean to be an XCOM? What does it mean to be commanded? Why are the aliens a threat, and how should we feel about that? It investigated those little square rooms of the base and pondered just not how they looked, but how they felt. Often, adapting a franchise to a new genre falters either by trying to be too faithful or not enough. There's a fine balance in trying to service fans of the original while also making the most of whatever medium you're moving into. And I can see why many would say that the Bureau was bad because it was too radical a departure from XCOM UFO Defense. Especially when compared to Enemy Unknown, the two have very little in common. But this is a good thing. Those three pillars of the Bureau, its setting, its systems, and its story, would not have come out of a more faithful adaptation. The developers couldn't have dug into what an alien invention really means from a historical and mechanical perspective if it had stuck to the computer monitors and pointer-driven commands of the original. It kept the spirit of UFO defense and let it soar, upwards, not downwards, forwards, not backwards, and twirling, always twirling towards the future. The Bureau doesn't need a sequel. It is a self-contained story, one that told the tale of XCOM before Enemy Unknown. An easy answer of updating it for an 80s Cold War era would have just been riffing on what came previously. There is plenty that could have been done to improve it with a second pass, but without the right vehicle, it just wouldn't feel right. But as an example of what happens when XCOM goes on a genre vacation, it proved the viability of translating this franchise beyond remaking and retooling UFO Defense. I mean, with some examples, an XCOM visual novel could deepen that on-base interaction and dark military bent without the need to facilitate the other aspects. An XCOM first-person game could finally deliver on that horror that Somi hinted at here. An XCOM racing game could be good. Whatever the future holds for this franchise, I hope that it can learn from some of the successes of the Bureau to forge a new path. After all, XCOM is at its best when it follows its own advice. Survive, adapt, win.